Students, welcome to your Circulation Hub. So today we are going to start with a new chapter, which is acids, bases and salts. And this is the second chapter from class 10 CBSE, and this is the chapter from the chemistry science. So this is the lecture one. So this is your master teacher Shubhra Gaurav. So let's start with the chapter. If you have ever downloaded a Telegram app from Play Store or iOS, then join our Telegram channel. All kinds of PDFs, tests, workbooks, notes will be uploaded in this Telegram channel itself, and the link of our Telegram channel has been provided in the description box below. So join the channel soon as possible. So let's start with the chapter. Now we need to know about what are indicators. Now, indicators are a kind of substances which helps us, which indicates us that a particular solution which is in front of us, or the solution which we are using, whether they are acidic in nature or whether they are basic in nature. Now let's discuss what it defines. The substances around us have acidic as well as basic nature. Now substances which are around us, some of them have acidic in nature as well as they are having basic in nature. Now acidic substances are the substances which are sour in taste, and whereas the bases are bitter. Now this is a very similar one, that where acidic acids are sour in taste and bases are bitter in taste. By tasting some substances, we can differentiate them as acidic or basic substances. So it's very easy that we can tell that by tasting, we can differentiate that a particular solution is acidic or a particular solution we are basic. But in laboratories, we test, not taste. So in laboratory, the solutions are not very much, they are not very much suitable for us to have drink of, have a drink of it or have to taste of it. So we need to test. So substances which are used in laboratory can be harmful if tested. So for them, some special kinds of substances are used to identify the acidic, basic or neutral nature. Now these substances are known as indicators. So the substances, so the solutions which are basically being used in the laboratories, we cannot test it, or by which can judge it that whether a solution is a sour test so that it is acidic and the solution is bitter test so that it is basic. So we cannot do in the laboratories, because each and every solution which are being given or which are being provided by the labs, they are very much harmful and they are very much toxic for our human body. So we cannot test it. So in those cases, how to understand the particular solution is acidic or basic? So in those cases, we use a substance which is known as indicators. Now, change in properties observed when they come in contact with an acidic or basic solution. So, the change in contact, change in property is basically being observed when the indicators comes in contact with the acidic or basic solutions. Now, chemical indicators are of two types. One is artificial and another is natural indicators. And litmus, red cabbage, turmeric, gyrose are some of the naturally occurring indicators around us. Now, chemical indicators are of, basically there are two kinds of indicators, two kinds of chemical indicators. One is known as the artificial indicator and one is known as the natural indicators. And the litmus, red cabbage, turmeric, gyrose are some of the naturally occurring indicators around us. So this is shown here as a litmus solution and this is shown here as a red cabbage. So this is the whole concept of water indicators. Hope you have understood about water indicators. And also I have taken the snapshot as well. These are very much important from the exam point of view. Also you have taken the noting as well. So let's move to the next slide. So these are the types of indicators. Now we will be discussing like this only. Like we will be discussing with the section wise. This is basically the total mind map, which will be very much useful for the your exam purposes, as well as this very basically helps you to know and helps you to basically to make the concepts, because it will be helping you in the exam. So this is the natural indicator, which has been divided in so many kinds of indicators, both in acidic, both in basic, how it changes, what happens. Like in natural indicator, one is litmus. Now litmus basically changes to red in color, where that is changes to blue in color. These are very much important. Take a snapshot of it, very much useful for your exam point of view. Then red cabbage leaf extract, then it turns that it is red in color in the acidic solution, and then it is green in color in the basic solution. Now flower of hydrangea plant is blue in color in the acidic solution, pink in color in the basic solution. And then turmeric, which is having no change in the acidic solution, but then it is having red in color in the basic solution. So this is, and then we, this is all the whole part of the natural indicator. Now let's move to the synthetic indicator. Now phenolphthalein is synthetic indicator, which is colorless in the acidic solution and becomes pink in basic solution. And then methyl orange, which is some red in color in the acidic solution and yellow in color in the basic solution. And then we have olfactory indicators, which is onion, and then characteristic smell, no smell in the basic solution and characteristic smell in acidic solution. Then vanilla essence, which is retained smell, this smell or color in the acidic solution, and no smell in the basic solution. And clove oil, and that is retained smell and loss of smell. So this is the whole concept of the types of indicators. This we have provided a mind map for you people to understand about it, and we will be discussing about each and every section of the types of the indicators. So we have taken a snapshot. So let's move to the next slide and discuss about each of them. So this is starting with the natural indicator. So this natural indicator is a type of indicator that can be found naturally and can determine whether the substance is an acidic substance or a basic substance. Now natural indicator is a type of indicator that can be found naturally and can can determine whether a substance is an acidic substance or a basic substance. So it is very much easy to understand that natural indicators is basically being founded naturally, and they determine whether a particular substance is in acidic solution or whether a particular substance is a basic solution. Now some examples of natural indicators are like red cabbage, turmeric, grape juice, turnip skin, curry powder, cherries, beetroots, onion, tomato, etc. So the examples which are always being around us, most of them are naturally made, and that's why these are also can act as a natural indicators as well, because red cabbage is very much common. Then turmeric is very much common, we used to use in the cooking purposes. So most of your households, your mothers used to use turmeric in their cooking. So who loves turmeric in their cooking, please let me know in the comment section below how much people have seen about a turmeric. So if you have ever seen a turmeric, then please do any kind of small household experiments, from which you will be able to understand whether the turmeric is how turmeric is working in the as the indicators. Now let me know in the comment section below how you have done it. And then grape juice is very much common, and then turnip skin is also very much common, and like this, these all are basically the common examples. Now some flowers like hydrangeas can determine the acidity or the basicity of the soil, and these flowers become blue if the soil is acidic purple, if the soil is neutral, and pink if the soil is basic. Now the intensity of the color depends on the amount of acid or base present in the soil, and soil which is highly acidic bears deep blue flowers, whereas soil which is highly basic gives deep pink flowers. So many flowers like hydrangeas, they can determine the acidity or basicity of the soil. So basically they can determine whether the soil is in acidic condition or the soil is in basic condition by flowers like hydrangeas, and these flowers become blue in the soil if the soil is acidic. So this flower changes the color according to the condition of the soil. If the condition of the soil is acidic, then it changes to blue in color. If the soil condition is neutral, it changes to purple. And if the soil condition is basic, then it turns to pink in color. The intensity of the color depends on the amount of acid or base present in the soil. Soil which is highly acidic bears deep blue colors. So, if the soil is highly acidic, then it changes to deep blue color, whereas the soil which is highly basic, it changes to deep pink color. So, we have shown in front of you the turmeric image, then about the red cabbage image, and then about the deep root image. So, this is the whole concept of natural indicators. So, we have understood about the natural indicators very clearly. So, let's move to the next slide. So, this is the synthetic indicator. So, synthetic indicators are basically those indicators which are being man-made. So, let's discuss about it. Synthetic indicators are which are synthesized in the laboratory. So, these are the kind of indicators which are being synthesized in the laboratory. And examples of synthetic indicators are including like phenolphthalein, then methyl orange, etc. Litmus paper is also an example of a synthetic indicator. Now, synthetic indicators are indicators which are being synthesized in laboratory. So, these are basically man-made and which are being synthesized in the laboratory itself. And examples of synthetic indicator, for example, the first example is a phenolphthalein, methyl orange, etc. Litmus paper is also a kind of synthetic indicator only because it is of this litmus paper is being obtained from a plant called lichens. And from lichens, the litmus paper used to come up, and that's why the processes which is being done, it is forming as a synthetic indicator only. So, litmus paper is also an example of synthetic indicator. So, this is the images of the synthetic indicator. This is the methyl orange, and this is the phenolphthalein indicator. So, this is the whole concept of the synthetic indicators. Hope you have understood about it. Take the snapshots of each and indicators we have been discussing with. These are very much important from the exam point of view. So, let's move to the next slide. The olfactory indicator. Now, olfactory indicators are basically those indicators by which we can understand by the smell which is being coming through. If the solution is acidic, then the smell would be different. If the soil, if the particular substance is basic, then it will be having a different smell. So, the olfactory indicators are those indicators which basically depends on the variation, it causes variation in smells from which we can understand. Now, let's read what it defines. An olfactory indicator is a substance whose smell varies depending on whether it is mixed with an acidic or basic solution. So, basically, the smell gets variation, the variation of smell occurs, and for which, depending on that, it is mixed with an acidic or basic solution. Now, olfactory indicators can be used in the laboratory to test whether a solution is a base or an acid, a process called the olfactory indicator. Now, olfactory indicators can be also been used in the laboratory to test whether the solution is a base or an acid, a process called olfactory titration. Now, the olfactory indicators are also being used in the laboratories as well to check whether a base is, whether a substance is a whether a substance is a base and then about is a base or an acid, a process which is called as the olfactory titration. Now, simply put, olfactory indicators are substances which have different order in acid and base solutions. Now, simply the olfactory indicators are substances which have a different order in acid and base solutions, and so. For example, vanilla extract has a characteristic pleasant smell, onion and clove oil, etc. So, the vanilla extract has a characteristic pleasant smell, which and the onion and clove oil as well. So, these are the types of olfactory indicator which are being found in our surroundings. So, this is the image of the vanilla extract, this is the image of the clove oil. Hope you have understood the olfactory indicator as well, like the other two we have discussed till now. So, hope you have also taken the snapshot of it. So, let's move to the next slide. So, this we are starting with acids. So, till the first lecture, we will be discussing the total concept which is being given in the NCERT book about acids. We will be discussing about that. On the next upcoming lectures, we will be discussing with the pieces as well as with the salts. So, till through this lecture, we will be discussing with acids. So, let's know what are acids. Now, acids, till now what we are able to understand that the acids are basically sour in taste. They used to turn glutamate to red and they basically they are very much harmful. In our convince, they are very much harmful because they are very toxic substances. But then all acids are not toxic. Some acids we used to use in our daily life as well. But then the mineral acids or the kind of acids which are being found from the earth itself, they are very much toxic in nature. And we should stay a little bit away from those acids or take preventive measures while using those acids, because it causes a very destruction to ourselves as well, and also the belongings that we are using. So let's read what it defines. Then acids are sour in taste. They are very sour in taste, and then turn blue litmus to red and dissolve in water and to release H+ ions. So the two conditions we know earlier itself, but then when we dissolve the acidic solutions in water, it starts to release H+ ions. Now then, example of acids like sulfuric acid, which is a mineral acid, and that is H2SO4 for the formula is, then acetic acid, which is just a natural acid, which is, or organic acid, which is CH3COOH, and nitric acid, which is again a mineral acid, which is HNO3, etc. Now then, properties of acids, on what basis we can identify that a particular solution is acid, and then what are the characteristics are also included. So the properties of acids are, acids have a sour in taste, turns blue litmus to red, and acid solution conducts electricity. Now acidic solutions also has a good property that it's used to conduct electricity and then release H+ ions in the aqueous solution. So in front of you we have displayed the bottle of the sulfuric acid. So this is the whole concept of acids. Hope you have understood about the concepts of the acid as well. Hope you have also taken the snapshot of it. It is very much important from the exam point of view. So let's move to the next line and discuss the upcoming part of the chapter. So these are the type of acids. The first one is the natural acid and the next one is the mineral acid. Natural acids are basically found in the fruits, in vegetables, different kinds of vegetables, in solutions like turmeric, and all these are the natural acids. Now mineral acids are what acids? They are sulfuric acid, nitric acid, hydrochloric acid, then carbonic acid is also a mineral acid, but then it is a weak acid for which it is being placed in the natural acid classification only. So these are the type of two types of acid. We will be discussing in detail and in depth about all the kind of all the parts which are being given by the NCERT. So let's start with the first type of the acids, which is the natural acids. So this is the natural acids. Now acids which are being obtained from the natural sources. So the acids or the acidic solutions which are being obtained from the natural sources are called the natural acids or the organic acids. So this is very easy to understand that the acidic solutions which are being obtained from natural sources are called the natural acids or organic acids. Now examples of the natural acids like methanoic acid, HCOOH, acetic acid, CH3COOH, and oxalic acid, which is C2H2O4. Now these are the types of the natural acids which are also being found, and there are many natural acids. And so we have displayed with the formic acid as well. Now these natural acids used to come from various substance, various from various injected from organisms as well, from vegetables as well, from fruits as well. Now these are the risky natural acids. Even our body also secretes acid which is very harmful, which is the known as the hydrochloric acid. Now that is also, means our body is also used to secrete acid. But then if the level of the acidity increases in our body, then it starts to give to irritation, then it causes indigestion. So all the criteria that happens. So these are the concept of the natural essence. Hope you have understood about natural essence, and we have also placed a image in front of you, that is of the formic acid from the laboratory. So we have understood about natural essence. So let's move to the next slide. So these are the organic acids or the natural essence and their sources. Now where the natural acids or the organic acids are found from, we need to know about that as well. So acids like acetic acid, they have been found from vinegar. Now acids like azorbic acid, which have been found in the sources like guavas and amla, fruits like, and then citric acid, fruits like lemon, and then orange and other citrus food. Now lactic acid, sour milk curd, methanoic acid, ant sting, nettle leaf sting, oxalic acid, tomato, and then tartaric acid, which is tamarind. So these are the sources, and as well as we have mentioned the acids names as well, from which, from where they are being found from. So hope you have understood about the, so the organic acids or natural acids, from where they are being found from, or the sources. So hope you have taken the snapshot as well. So let's move to the next slide. So let's start with the mineral acids. So these are very easy concepts. You will be able to understand that each and every part of the chapter we are ending in seconds. So these are very easy concepts, and so for which from this chapter is very easy chapter, but then it's a bit a lengthy chapter as well, because three types of solutions we have discussed in this chapter. The NCERT has discussed in these three types in one chapter itself. So it's a bit a lengthy chapter, but then the concepts which are being present within this chapter are very easy, because you can see now only, because we need to cross each and every slides within seconds. We can understand, because crossing a slide means we are understanding each concepts. So we can understand that these are so small concepts, so easy concepts, so that we can clear out within seconds. So hope we can also make good marks from this chapter as well. This is a good scoring chapter as well. So let's discuss about mineral acids. So acids that are prepared from minerals are known as the mineral acids. Now acids which are being prepared from minerals are basically the mineral acids. An example, inorganic acids, man-made acids, or synthetic acids are also known as the mineral acids as well. Now then, the acids which are being inorganic in nature, the acids which are being prepared from man-made, or whether they are synthetic, so these are classified under the mineral acid section only. Now let's discuss some examples of it, like hydrochloric acid, which is very toxic, and then sulfuric acid as well, as it is also very toxic, then nitric acid, then carbonic acid, then phosphoric acid. Now these are all the acids which are very toxic, but then there are many acids, mineral acids as well, but then we have discussed a small number of them. So mineral acids are basically those kind of acids which are inorganic in nature, which are being prepared from the minerals which are the synthetic or the man-made. So these are all the mineral acids. Hope you have understood about the mineral acids as well. We have also shown a vessel of HCl in front of you in this slide. So let's move to the next slide. Hope you have taken the snapshot of this slide as well. These are very much important from the exam point of view. So let's move to the next slide. So these are the reactions. We will be discussing about the reactions of what happens with what when acid reacts with the substances of the metals, like when acid reacts with metals. So we are going to start with this one. Then what happens when acid reacts with metals? Now when acid reacts with metals, acids give hydrogen gas along with the respective salt, they react with the metal. So when the acids used to react with the metal, two kinds of things they used to give as a product or as a result. The first one is a salt and the second one is a hydrogen. So the hydrogen, so metal plus acid equals to salt plus hydrogen. We need to remember this equation only. Then it would be easy just to place the metal in the metal part. We need to place the acid in the acidic part, and then the salt in the salt part, and hydrogen. So it is very easy if we know about the metal plus acid and then salt plus hydrogen. If you know this equation only, this basic general equation, then there will be no problem if the exam used to ask about the examples, what happens about the examples of the reaction of the acids with metals. So let's discuss with the first example, which is hydrogen gas and zinc chloride are formed when hydrochloric acid reacts with the zinc metal. Now Zn plus 2HCl, which occurs and forms ZnCl2 plus H2. Now zinc, when reacts with hydrochloric acid, it is forming zinc chloride plus hydrogen. So this happens when basically reaction of the acid with the metals, and then we have seen this salt is being given out as a product, which is ZnCl2 or the zinc chloride, and then hydrogen or the H2 is being given out as a gaseous form and the salt in the aqueous state. So this equation has also been balanced. And why do we balance? For that, if we not know, means if we want that conceptual view as well, we have uploaded in our YouTube as well. So look at that video in the I section, which is being mentioned in the above. Clicking on the I section, it will be showing with the video of the chemical equations and the chemical reactions and equations, the first chapter of the class 10 chemistry. So watch that video, it will be similar, crystal clear. That concept will also be crystal clear. Now let's do the second example, which is hydrogen gas and sodium sulfate are formed when sulfuric acid reacts with the sodium metal. Now 2Na plus H2SO4, which is forming as Na2SO4 plus H2. Now Na means sodium is reacting with sulfuric acid, which is forming as Na2SO4, which is the sodium sulfate, and also hydrogen is being released. Now salt is sodium sulfate and the hydrogen is H2 only. Now both of them are in aqueous state. So this is the two examples that we have discussed from the reactions of the acids with metals. Hope you have understood and try to remember this metal plus acid equals salt plus hydrogen. This only would be helpful for you people. Not to remember these examples will automatically come if you remember this general equation only. So we have understood the reactions of the acids with metals. So let's move to the next slide. This is the how do we test for hydrogen. Now we can also test for hydrogen by a sound which is known as a pop sound. By hearing a pop sound, we can identify that the hydrogen has been released or not. If there is no pop sound, we can identify that the hydrogen is not released from the reaction. Now mostly on all the reactions, not mostly in all the reactions in the acidic solutions which occurs with acids, now most in all the reactions only hydrogen used to come up, from which a pop sound used to occur. But then what is that pop sound? What that pop sound is basically indicating to us? So we will be discussing about that only. So hydrogen is the most ample element or the chemical substance that is accessible in our universe. So hydrogen is a very most ample element or a chemical substance that is very much accessible in our universe. It makes up 90% of all the atoms. It is the smallest and the lightest of all the elements, having the atomic number 1 and the atomic weight as 1.008. Now it is the most smallest and most lightest of all the elements, having atomic number 1 and the atomic weight as 1.008. Now hydrogen is mostly seen in the form of the gas and is colorless, odorless, but flammable. Hydrogen is mostly seen in the form of gas, and then they are colorless, odorless, but they are very much flammable. So the gas evolved after reaction of acid with metal can be tested by bringing a lighted candle near it. Now the gas which has been evolved after a reaction of acid with metal can be tested by bringing a lighted candle near it, and if the gas bumps with a pop sound, then it confirms the evolution of the hydrogen gas. Now only we have said before starting the topic called the test for hydrogen, if there is a pop sound, it will indicate and it will confirm that the evolution of the hydrogen gas is done from the following reaction taking place, and then burning with pop sound is a characteristic test for the hydrogen gas. Now burning with a pop sound is a characteristic test for the hydrogen gas. So burning with a pop sound helps us to know that a characteristic test for the hydrogen gas. So this is the whole concept of the test for hydrogen. Hope you have understood about test for hydrogen as well. So if you are able to understand such small such concepts in within seconds, then hope you have understood that these chapter is very easy. So like the video, because we make you understand such easy concepts. So these easy concepts will be such easier for you people in further chapter as well. So hit the like button so we get motivation from that. And hit the like button as much as you can, because all our efforts provided by us to you people to understand about these concepts will be very much helpful to our people, and for which that hitting the like button helps us to motivate us so that we also prepare new videos for you people to understand. And hit the subscribe button as well, so that the upcoming parts of this chapter, upcoming sessions for this chapter will be very much notified to you people by hitting the bell icon as well. So do the like, do the subscribe button as first as possible, and then the subscribing button helps the increase of the family with your master teachers like me and with you people. So now family also increases. So like the lecture and subscribe to the channel, and so share the video as much as you can with each and everyone around you. So test for the hydrogen, hope you have understood about it as well. So let's move to the next slide. This is the reaction of the acids with the metal carbonates. So this is the general formula, which is a carbonate plus acid equals to a salt plus carbon dioxide plus water. Now calcium carbonate plus hydrochloric acid, CaCl3 plus HCl equals to CaCl, that is CaCl2, that is calcium chloride plus CO2 plus H2O, that is water. So this is the reaction which happens with the reaction of acids with the metal carbonates. So this is the first example. Let's move to the second example. NaCO3 plus H2SO4 equals to NaSO4 plus CO2 plus H2. This is the second example. Sodium carbonate plus sulfuric acid equals to sodium sulfate plus carbon dioxide plus water. This is the second example. And the third example is the CuCl3, which is reacting with HNO3, that is forming CuNO3, and it is forming CO2, and then it is forming H2O. So these are the all three examples that think I said before as well. So don't need to remember all these examples, just remember about that general formula, which is carbonate plus acid equals salt plus carbon dioxide plus water. Remembering this general equation will be much more helpful than ever, that it will help you to just after remembering this a carbonate state of the metal, and then remembering an acidic solution as salt and carbon dioxide and water, you will be able to understand by placing this two solutions only. So try to remember these general concepts, is general equation of the reaction of acids with metal carbonates and the reaction of acids with metals as well, that we have discussed previous slide only. So try to remember these general equations, it will be much helpful for you people. So we have understood the reactions of the acids with metal carbonates as well. So let's move to the next slide. This is the reaction of the acids with the bicarbonates. The reaction of the acids also occurs with the bicarbonates as well. So let's discuss about it. Acids give carbon dioxide, respective salt and water, when they react with the metal hydrogen carbonate. The acids used to give out the CO2 gas, which is carbon dioxide gas, a particular salt as per the equation, as per the reaction as well, and then the water when they react with the metal hydrogen carbonate. Now acid plus metal hydrogen carbonate equals to salt plus carbon dioxide plus water. So we need to remember this general equation again, and remembering this general equation, the remembering of the equation out of all will also come automatically, because this equation, this general equations are only consisting of these examples itself. So just remember this general equations, it will be helpful for you people to know about the examples as well. So acid plus metal hydrogen carbonate equals to salt plus carbon dioxide plus water. Based on the general equation, we have found one example for people to 2NaCO3, which is aqueous in state, plus H2SO4, which is also aqueous in state, so it is forming NaCl plus CO2 plus H2O. So This is the for one the only one example which we have discussed from the reaction of the acids with bicarbonates. Hope you have understood about the reaction of the acids with bicarbonates, that how acids used to keep up carbon dioxide and then respective salt as per as this is on the reaction of the acid as well as with the metal hydrogen carbonate, and then about the keeping out of the that how they react with the metal hydrogen carbonate. So hope you have understood the reaction of the acids with the bicarbonates as well. We have discussed about what happens in the reaction, and we have also discussed the general equation, and we have also discussed one example from it. So we have understood about the reactions of the acids with bicarbonates. So let's move to the next slide. So this is the test for the evolution of the carbon dioxide gas. The carbon dioxide used to move out, and for which there is also a test like the hydrogen gas that we have discussed previously only. Now we will be discussing about test for the evolution of the carbon dioxide gas. So let's discuss about it. So carbon dioxide turns lime water milky when passed through it. Now this is the characteristic test for the carbon dioxide gas. The gas evolved because of the reaction of the acid with metal carbonate or the metal hydrogen carbonate turns lime water milky. Now this shows that the gas is carbon dioxide gas, and this happens because of the formation of the white precipitate of the calcium carbonate. Now carbon dioxide used to turn lime water into milky and when passed through it. And this is the characteristic test for the carbon dioxide gas. This is a characteristic test for the carbon dioxide gas only. And then the gas evolved because of the reaction of the acid with the metal carbonate or the metal hydrogen carbonate turns lime water milky as well. So this shows that the gas is carbon dioxide. So whenever we will find that the lime water has turned milky, and we will be able to understand that because of the presence of the carbon dioxide only, that the lime water has turned milky. So from that only we can understand that this shows the presence of the carbon dioxide. Then this happens because of the formation of a white precipitate of the calcium carbonate. That is CaOH2, it is calcium hydroxide plus carbon dioxide equals calcium carbonate, which is CaCO3 plus H2O, which is water. And then calcium carbonate plus water plus carbon dioxide, which is calcium hydrogen carbonate. That is CaCO3 plus H2O plus CO2, which is CaHCO3. These are two examples, and then but when excess of the carbon dioxide is passed through the lime water, it makes milky color of the lime water disappear. Now the if a large amount of carbon dioxide is being passed through the milky color of the lime water, then the means the through the lime water it will basically make the milky color to be disappeared. Now this happens because of the formation of the calcium hydrogen carbonate, as calcium hydrogen carbonate is soluble in water. The milky color of the solution of the mixture gets disappeared. Now this happens because of the formation of the calcium hydrogen carbonate, and as calcium hydrogen carbonate is formed and it is very much soluble in water, and thus the milky color of the solution which has been formed, it gets simply disappeared. This is the whole concept of the test for the evolution of the carbon dioxide gas as well. We have discussed what happens, what is visible in front of us when carbon in presence of the carbon dioxide in the solution called the lime water, and we have discussed about the two equations as well, and we have also discussed when excess of carbon dioxide is being provided in the lime water, what happens to it. And so hope you have understood about the test for the evolution of the carbon dioxide. So let's move to the next slide. Hope you have also been taking the snapshots as well, or been noting down in as handmade notes, which will be very much helpful for the exam point of view. So let's move to the next slide. This is what are common in acids. So what is common in acids? Now basically acids gives hydrogen gas when they react with the metal. Now acids basically gives hydrogen gas when they basically reacts with metal, and this shows that the acids contains hydrogen. So acids give hydrogen gas, H2 gas, when they react with the metal, any metal. Now this shows that all the acids contains hydrogen. For example, the hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid, nitric acid, etc. When all the acid is dissolved in water, it starts to dissociate hydrogen, and then the dissociation of the hydrogen ion in aqueous solution is a common property in all the acids. Now, then acid is dissolved in acid. Acidic solution is being dissolved in water, it starts to dissociate the hydrogen. And the dissociation of the hydrogen ion in the aqueous solution is the common property in all the acids. It is a common property only. If it is a strong acid, it is a weak acid. In any case, if we dissolve an acid, we simply pour the acid in the water. Then basically the dissociation of the dissolved and disolvent acid is being dissolved in water. So the dissociation is always occurring. So this is because of the dissociation of the hydrogen ion in the aqueous solution, acid shows acidic behavior. So because we have poured the acid solution in water, for which it has starts to show because the dissociation of the aqueous solution has occurred and dissociation of the hydrogen ion. And that's why it is showing the acidic behavior. Now, then examples like hydrochloric acid gives hydrogen ion and chloride ion when it is dissolved in water. Now, just breakdown of it occurs. So, hope you have understood about the common in acids. What is the common in all the acidic solutions? Now, we have discussed what happens. Like when we dissolve the acidic solutions in water, what happens? Like the H plus ions gets moved out and it starts to show the acidic behavior, and what we have discussed with this concept with an example of hydrochloric acid, what happens, it used to give up hydrogen ion which is H plus and chloride ion which is Cl minus when it is dissolved in water. So when we dissolve hydrochloric acid in water, H plus and Cl minus used to comes out. So hope you have understood about the common in acids as well. So hope you also taken the screenshot as well. So let's move to the next slide. So this is the nature of the acids. So the first one is a strong acid and the next one is a weak acid. So strong acids, what are the strong acids? Like acids like nitric acid, sulfuric acid, hydrochloric acid, these are strong acids. Weak acids like acetic acid, formic acid, citric acid, tartaric acid, these are weak acids. Now the acids are also being divided into two parts. One is strong acid, one is weak acid. Now we need to take preventive measures for strong acids. We take weak acids, we do not need any preventive measures, but then usage of over of acids, then it will provide means if we use too much acid in our means too much acidic materials, like if we use too much lemons, and then it will be providing a kind of excess of acidic level in our body. But then weak acids doesn't provide, I mean, it doesn't cause any harm to us. It will cause good in us only. But then strong acid will take some preventing measures while we use it. So let's discuss in detail about the strong acids as well as in the weak acids and about their examples as well. So let's move to the next slide and discuss about the strong acids and weak acids. So this is, we are starting with the strong acids. So what is strong acid? So now strong acid is one that is completely dissociated or ionized in an aqueous solution. A strong acid is the one that is completely being dissociated or completely get ionized in an aqueous solution, and it is a chemical species with a high capacity to lose a proton which is H plus. Now it is a chemical species which is having a high capacity to lose a proton which is known as a H plus, and in water a strong acid loses only one proton, and then which is captured by the water to form hydronium ion. Now then when the water is being, when the strong acid is being dissolved in water, then it starts to release a loss of one proton which is H plus, and then that is being captured because we know the formula of the water, that is H2O. Now getting another H plus ion, what will happen? Another getting one another proton which has H plus ion, what will happen? It will form an hydronium ion which is H3O plus. Now HA, which is in aqueous, and then which is a strong acid, and then which is dissolving with H2O, and then it is forming as H3O plus, and then A minus. So this is what happens, is the strong acid. It is strong acid when it is being dissolved in water, it starts to release, it gets basically completely gets dissociated or gets completely ionized, for which it starts to release or starts to give out one proton as H plus ion, and when it, and then it gets captured, and that each glass has is basically being captured by the water, and the water is basically forming to an hydrogen ion. So this is what happens in the strong acids. We have discussed through a given equation as a general equation as well. So we have understood the strong acids. We have shown the nitric acid, HNO3 image in front of you in this slide. So let's move to the next slide. Hope you have taken the snapshot of this slide as well. These are very much important from the exam point of view. So let's start with the weak acids. Now what is weak acid? So basically in the strong acid we have seen that the acid means completely gets dissociate and completely gets ionized, and for which an H plus ion has been released as a result of it. One proton has been released. But then in weak acid what happens in it? A weak acid is an acid that partially dissociates into its ions in an aqueous solution or water. Now weak acid is an acid that partially dissociates into ions and in aqueous solution or water. In contrast, a strong acid is being fully being dissociated into ions in water. Now this is partially getting dissociated, not completely, it is getting partially dissociated into ions and then in an aqueous solution or water. In contrast, a strong acid is being fully getting dissociated into its ions in the water, we have discussed now only, and the conjugate base of the weak acid is a weak base as well. The conjugate base of a weak acid is also a weak base, and then the conjugation of the acid of the weak base is a weak acid, and then at the same concentration of the weak acid is also having a higher pH value than the strong acid. At the same concentration of the weak acids, they are having a higher pH value than the strong acid. So we have displayed an image of the ascorbic acid in front of you. So this is the whole concept of the weak acid. Hope you have understood about weak acids, and we have discussed what happened and comparing to the strong acids, what happens to weak acids, and what is at the same concentration, what happens to the weak acids. And we have also tried to understand to you people about the weak acids by comparing it with the weak bases as well. When it conjugates with weak bases, what happens then? So this is the whole concept of the weak acids. Hope you understood about it. So let's move to the next slide. These are the list of the strong acids. Like in the first one is the HClO4, which is the perchloric acid. Then the HI, which is the hydroiodic acid. Then HBr, which is the hydrobromic acid. HCl, which is the hydrochloric acid. HNO3, which is nitric acid. H2SO4, which is the sulfuric acid. These all are the strong acids. Hope you have taken a snapshot of it. Very much important from the exam point of view. So let's move to the next slide and discuss about the list of the weak acids as well. So this is the list of the weak acids, which is the first one is a formic acid, acetic acid, citric acid, tartaric acid. So these all are the list of the weak acids. Hope you have understood and hope you have also taken the snapshot. Nothing to understand about these list, but then you need to take the snapshot of it. Hope you have taken the snapshot of it. Just as examples of the weak acids, we have taken a snapshot of it. So let's move to the next slide. Now the most important thing, just the cautionary preventive measures. Now the safety for ourselves. Now we always should be just, we should not do any kind of mischief or just for fun. We should not use strong acids. Now moving in a lab, in a chemistry lab, and then using the strong acids for our fun, never do that. That would be the most idiotic work we have ever done. Never do those kind of mischief. But then beforehand, wear protective gear, goggles, long sleeve cloths and gloves. You should be protected and get covered from while using the acids and bases. Do not allow the acids to come in contact with skin or eyes. If that happens, I am surely telling to you now itself that if that happens at any moment, the part that has been touched with that strong acid or a strong base, the particular part will get severely being burned, and that severe burn will not be getting like without means using different kinds of medicines. Nothing will occur in that. With your total life expectancy, that bond will be present within yourself. Just it will, by time, it will get, just it will get dried up. But then the particular bond will be for your whole life expectancy. So don't ever, means never have in contact with the acid with your skin or eyes when it is about the, means we are talking about the strong acids and strong bases. Never do that. Then limit the amount of acids transported for usage around the house. Now we need to use, then we need to limit the amount of acids that has been transported for usage around the house. We need to limit that. Then cap the bottles of the acid finish tightly. Now while using the in the strong acids in the lungs, we have not means we have not covered the tap in them. We have loosely covered the tap or cap of the bottles, and we have kept our strong acid. Strong acid like we are using sulfuric acid, and the bottle of the cap of the bottle we have not tightly intact. Then what will happen? If it accidentally gets fallen in some place, then total bond will occur. We should be very, very safe while using these kinds of acids. While we use, while we stop using, in each and every moment, we need to be very, very much safe while using it. Do not mix the acids or bases together without first finding out their compatibility. Now, do not mix acids and bases together. Now we know that acids and bases when goes together forms as a neutralization reaction, but then there is a compatibility. If we in both quantities and in some quantities or in higher quantities, if we are going to dissolving the acids and bases, then it will cause huge damage to our scenery. So we need to know about, and we need to find and do research about their compatibility as well, that whether a particular solution, whether a particular acid is able to combat will with the particular base that is being reacting over it. If too much local heat is being released, and then the vessel will be getting slashed, and it will cause danger over us only. Now check to make sure bottles are in fit condition. Old bottles, a bottle has been cracked. Never use those vessels to keep the strong acids or strong bases. Never use those things to keep. We have to take the clean, we have to take the feed bottles which are in feed condition. We need to take those vessels, those bottles while storing acids. Now store acids in a wooden cabinet. You can also store acids in a wooden cabinet as well. Keep the acids and bases stored separately to prevent potential reactions. Now if by any chance the acids and bases are being mixed together, they cause potential reactions or the neutralization reaction. But then that is very much dangerous. That's why we need to keep the acids and bases very much separated from each other, so that they doesn't get mixed with each other or doesn't get react with each other. Now another very important cautionary thing, that is we should always add acids to water, not the opposite one, not the vice versa one. If we do that, simply if we ever do that, then hence God knows it will only just, means anything can happen. Either your hands will get burned, either your face, either your body parts. In any case, it will happen. A strong and dangerous thing will happen. So always add acid to water. Never do that. Because what happens, I am telling practically only, when acid is being added to water, then the hydronium ion that we have discussed in the strong acids part only, it has been formed in the water itself. So the water, the acid has got dissociated. But then, if you have ever put, if you have ever added water into acid, what will happen? The water is having H2O. Now, acid is full of H plus ions, and then it is getting totally increased. The increasing of protons is occurring in acid, and means the strength of the strong acid has also become in double increase. Because H2, so double is occurring. Now, it will simply get out of control, for which it will do thing, it will splash the vessel in which it is being kept. It will completely cause damage and cause destruction in the particular lab. So take the care of these all safety measures which are being given while using the strong acids or strong bases in labs. Hope you have understood about this. These are very much important from the exam point of view as well. So hope you have taken the snapshot of it as well. So let's move to the next slide. Thank you for watching the video. Here the video ends, and hope all your concepts are crystal clear from this part of the chapter, which is the acidic part of the chapter. Hope all your concepts are clear, and if you have any doubt, mention it in the comment section below. After seeing this video, or after reading with the enzymatic chapter, after seeing this video only, if you have any kinds of doubt, mention it in the comment section below. We take lot of efforts to build such conceptual videos for you people. So like the video. One like is very much important, and not one like, a number of, means each and every viewer should be having a like, because that helps us to, means it inspires us, that motivates us to build such conceptual and such wonderful videos for you people in the future as well. Now subscribe the channel, because the upcoming videos which are very much important from this chapter as well as from the class 10 syllabus as well. So subscribe the channel to get the updates from our channel, and hit the bell icon so that you can get the regular updates, and try to share the video with each and every students and each and every friends with you that are facing problems in such chapters that you have, means they have not been able to understand from the schools. So try to share this video with those people, and also try to share with those people who are being wishing to study, because due to this lockdown situation, due to this crisis, the many parents in our country has not been able to send their students, they have not been sending their children to the coaching centers, because to do the coaching fees they are unable to pay. But then our channel is extremely free, and we have a dream to make the coaching free in India. So try to share this video as much as you can, and make this video means this very much clear for you people. And the like target is about the 500 likes. I am making it a target, so cross about that box. And hope you understood about the concepts that we have discussed in this video. Hope you each and every concepts, hope it is crystal clear for you people. So thank you for watching the video. Until the next video, be practicing, be understanding about being culturing with this chapter only. So bye.